Iowa.
From high school to international wrestling, on the mat and beyond, this is the Potentially Dangerous Podcast with the guys from IAwrestle.
If you're a fighter, you like a fight. If you're an American, you like a fight. If you're an Iowa Hawkeye, you know you're going to get a fight.
Subscribe to our podcast on iTunes and all your podcast-friendly apps. And follow us on social media platforms at IAwrestle. Time to strap it up and get to the show.
It's all good. It's all good. We actually just went live here on Facebook. Coach Wignall's been busy with some things, and I appreciate you making the time. I know things are always moving and crazy here, so appreciate you tuning in to the live stream here on Facebook. We're also on Twitter now and on YouTube as well. So whenever you have a live show, things are obviously touch and go, depending on technology and everything we got going on. So this is the second week in a row that we've been live with you here on social media. You can catch the archives on all our podcast-friendly apps, but then also you can only watch the video version. We're going to have that on our Rokfin channel. That will be free. You just have to have a free account for that in order to watch the show, watch it on television as well. Got Coach Jack Wignall on here. How we kind of decided to get Coach on the show here was on Hager's Happy Hour on Fridays at 2. We were just talking a little bit through some new rules that were coming out, and Jack said, "I want to get on the show," and I thought Potentially Dangerous would be a better show to have you on, because that one's a little bit friendly for our viewers, I guess. So, first off, so you're the Ankeny head coach, but how did you get to Ankeny? How did you get to be in this position in one of the toughest conferences in the state, Coach?
Well, first, thanks for having me on, Tony. I appreciate it. I didn't mean to invite myself on, but when you were talking with who were you
Fellers.
Talking to? Fellers, yeah. There are some things I would like to have added, and so I sent a couple things out, and then we kind of got hooked up. But I've been at Ankeny for about 15 years, I think. I actually started out as a volunteer. My family and I moved down there, and I was a volunteer for 3 years, and then I was on an assistant on the paid assistant on staff. And then when we split schools, there were a couple job openings. You could stay at Ankeny High School or go to Centennial. And, I wanted to follow Dave Ewing's footsteps, so I decided to stay at Ankeny High School.
So what was it about following his footsteps? Obviously, the history there with Dave, but I mean, what was it about? Was it something about him personally, or just being able to take over a program like that? What was?
I think it was the Ankeny philosophy, which was always once a Hawk, always a Hawk. I knew Dave was still going to be teaching at the high school, and I wanted to be a part of that, and I wanted him to still be a part of the program. And that was the big draw. Just the history that went with the Ankeny Hawk program was just big, from when they started the program with Bob Vanderlinden in the early 60s to Bob Sharp to Dave Ewing. I wanted to be a part of that. And I knew that our club was really, really good, but it was going to take a few years for us to get to that point. That's why I wanted to do it. I just wanted to be a Hawk.
And how did you get into coaching? Because you mentioned the Melcher Dallas, and you're at 3M, I understand. So how did you get into this role initially, like going back to like your starting days?
So my dad actually had kind of started a program there. Not that he ever wrestled, but he wrote a letter to Dan Gable back in the mid to late 70s. I still have the letter somewhere. And it just talked about starting a program. That was really the catalyst for me. Wrestling is not big in Melcher, but it was something that I could kind of call my own and put my stamp on it. And so that was really something that was intriguing to me. It was just being able to do something different and something I could call my own. And so I did that. I had five kids on my wrestling team when I was a senior in high school. I didn't grow up in some of these areas that wrestling thrived. I just didn't. So it was just great. I didn't realize until I got to college and I wrestled at Iowa Central for a couple of years that there were kids like me that, had a passion for wrestling and knew that's what they wanted to do was coach and be involved in that because it's just a fantastic sport. I tell people all the time, I feel bad for kids that never give it a try or don't do it because they're missing out on something that'll change your life.
What's the biggest thing, the difference between, I mean, we're going to get into a lot of stuff here, but from a small school to coming into a big, you know, like Ankeny, you know, you would think you've got a ton of kids that would be in your program. What was that transition like for you?
Well, I coached at Ballard for 2 or 3 years when I was still in college, prior to the Weatherman brothers. In fact, I was trying to remember back. I think Trent might have been like a kindergartner. I helped run a youth club there, and I coached with Dave Mitchell with their middle school, who's Dave's the head coach at Luther College now. We were both going to Iowa State. So I had kind of a transition there where, you know, Melcher didn't have any kids to Ballard, who was starting to really develop their program. Just the number of kids you have in your wrestling room. I had to roll out the mats in the cafeteria when I was in high school. So going from
I think a lot of schools had to do that, right?
Yeah. So just having more workout partners for kids, you get to see the difference on how, you know, iron sharpens iron in that way. And then, you know, you get to Ankeny with Dave, when I was a volunteer and then a paid assistant before we split. I mean, having 80, 90 kids, 9 through 12, on your wrestling team, it's just incredible. And it's night and day different. It's so much fun to be a part of that.
So when you took over the program, what was the program? What was, I guess, overall, you know, how was the youth club? How did coach leave it? And, you know, what were your what were you walking into? Were you walking into a lineup with already, you know for sure there's going to be like a couple state champions, state qualifiers? What was that program like back when you stepped in?
Not at all. When we split, I think we had one returning state qualifier. That would have been John Ware, and he went north. So I knew it was going to be difficult. You're splitting a team that, you know, we were just coming off that season. I think we won 30 dual meets the year before with Austin Anderson and Xavier Quigley and Joel Lanning, that group of kids. We had a great season that year, and we graduated all those guys. So I knew it was going to be tough walking in, but when you're relatively young and you have a lot of excitement, you think, you know, you're just going to take the dragon or the tiger by the tail and just win. And that wasn't the case. It was really difficult. Another reason that I wanted to stay in Ankeny with Dave was because I watched him so close and I saw what he did. One of the things that always impressed me was that during the winter, he had on the schedule ACT testing, and that happened to be at the Valley Tournament at the time. So he was very detailed on what he did. I watched when he ordered workout gear and when he did this. So I wanted to keep that. And I wanted to be a part of that. But what I didn't realize is that when you become head coach, all that speeds up about 200 miles an hour. And I felt like for the first 2 or 3 years, I was just swimming. Even though I paid as much attention as I could, all the things that needed to be done, I was just swimming in never feeling like I got enough done. It was brutal. But you know, that wrestling background helps you stay the course, which is, I'm not going to give up and quit. That's not in the cards. But it was difficult. I think my first 3 years, we were still wrestling a 25, 30 meet dual season with tournaments that we were going to and different things. I think I won 15 dual meets in my first 3 years, 7-19, 8-18. It was brutal. And it's not that the kids weren't giving me everything they had. It's just that we didn't have a lot of those, guys that were just wrestlers. We were having kids wrestling varsity that were seniors in high school that had never been on a wrestling mat before.
Wow.
So when you are dealing with those kinds of things, you just do the best you can. And I remember after my second year, you asked about the club, incredible club. Dave Powell started that probably 40 years ago, 35 years ago. When he was starting to transition out of it after his son Carson graduated, some of the guys who had kids in that club kind of took it over and knew what they wanted to do. They used to have just one practice with everybody. And then it was divided out into elite kids and new kids. One of the best things they did was hire Mitch Mueller and Topher Ewing to run that elite group. That was a game changer. So after my second year, I got all the coaches together, my coaches and then the club coaches. And I'm like, guys, I don't know if I can keep doing this. I said, what am I doing wrong? And they're like, it's just the split. They're coming. I said, I hope so, because this has taken a toll on my family, my mental status, my work, everything. And, fast forward 5 more years, and I'm sitting here talking to you, and we had our best finish in history for a while. They won back in 71, and Dave Ewing had some good teams, and we ended up 7th, placed 4 kids, and my best year by far. So it's been a transition, that's for sure.
So let's chat a little bit about the last couple of years. We've been blessed with having some amazing talent up and down the lineup. I don't want you to call any specific names out there, because I'm sure every one of them has a certain spot in your heart, I guess, to say. So, looking back at those starter years, and when you have success, have you approached your practices any different? Of, is mentality different now than it was back then? Are expectations higher now with, these high level guys, the Caleb Ratchie going D1, and then the likely other ones that would be coming here soon? I guess what's the transition been like for you through the years?
That's a great question. I thought a little bit about this over time, and that, I followed Dave Ewing, and I loved the way he coached, his intensity and the way he did things. And I tried to emulate myself a little bit the way he did things, especially that first couple of years. I mean, we were practicing two and a half hours a night, and I was just grinding them down. And, when you don't have kids that are true wrestlers, that they were really struggling with that. And my coaches were too. So I had to take a kind of a step back and reevaluate who I am as a coach, what my philosophies were a little bit, and see what we could do to do things different. Coming into that third year, I really, made practices more efficient, cut down on practice time. We worked hard, but it was in a much more efficient manner. Coaches loved it. Kids loved it. Each year I've been able to change that a little bit. And that's probably the thing that I've done the most, is just reflect on the season. Early on, I spent a lot of time on making our schedule, and I still do that with the tournaments that I can schedule. Taking a step back after the season's over, talking to my coaches, what do we need to do? What are some things that we can do differently? I know 2 years ago, after the season, we got to get stronger, and we got a guy that did some strength and conditioning for us during the season. To me, that was a game changer. I also noticed that coming out of Christmas break, we struggled to get back on track. So 2 years ago, we had Red Oak, we had a state place finisher for Ankeny as an assistant down there. And so we got together over Christmas break and had a couple practices because you just don't wrestle as hard against your guys as you do other teams. So they came in and we had some really good practices over Christmas break. And to me, I think those two things were huge in our jump that 2 years ago. We were going to do the same thing this year, but we got so sick over Christmas break that we just had to shut it down. Osage was going to come down for a couple days and roll around. I went to college with their assistant, but we had to shut it down. But we still did the lifting. I think that reflecting of the seasons and making sure we're doing the right things is the most important.
So forward thinking here, and I felt this probably should have been thought about like 3-5 years ago, how crazy girls wrestling is in Iowa. Like it's exploded, and I'm from Johnston, been in the program in and out of it here since I've had kids the last 5 years. And one thing that we were talking about on the show on the Happy Hour show was girls wrestling not being sanctioned. I talked with Louis Curtis last week on Potentially Dangerous about that as well. And CIML, let's just start there because you're at, you know, Ankeny's in that. I don't see much participation at all in it. And as coming from a coach at Ankeny at a big program, big school, What do you think are some of the struggles that we have here in the metro of why girls wrestling isn't more popular as it is clear up in, you know, Northeast Iowa? It's crazy.
Sure. I think that part of it is, you can look across the state in any sport. They're having trouble finding coaches and referees. I know for us that, you know, 8 through 12, we've probably got 90, 95 kids out for wrestling. And, to dedicate a coach to that or try to dedicate a coach to that, we're working all the time. It's very, very difficult to, allocate resources to that. Not that I don't think it's important, but just having somebody that can do that is difficult to find. And I think that that's probably maybe what's holding the state back as a whole. I know a few years ago, Eric Whitcomb kind of called me out on Twitter. There was a post about girls wrestling, and I said, I'm gonna retweet this until Iowa gets wrestling, girls wrestling. And he kind of called me out. He goes, well, what are you doing to help? Guess what? I wasn't doing a lot. So I kind of toned that down a little bit. I would love to see, Iowa get girls wrestling. I have 6 daughters. I would love to have started that 10 years ago to get some of some of my girls involved. But it just wasn't happening then. So I take a perspective like this with girls wrestling that, I don't know what other states are doing and how that looks. I would hate for Iowa to say, oh, we're going to do this and not have a solid plan in place to, make sure we have the coaches, the facilities, the events, to do it right. We don't want to do it halfway and then have it not work out and think, well, you know, that's so-and-so's fault. I think we need to have a good solid plan in place, look at what other states are doing and try to replicate that the best we can. But it needs to happen. And I'm a supporter of that, but right now I don't have the resources from a coaching standpoint to allocate to that.
And that's probably where a lot of people are, is who's going to coach what. And from what I'm gathering too, is you have to have maybe somebody that's already on the program or close to the program be like, you know what, I'm going to go out. This is all I'm going to do. I'm going to try to get as many girls as we can. And it's got to be somebody probably on staff at the school too that can, you know, start recruiting. I mean, it's just like junior high wrestling where you're trying to pull bodies from all over the place, right? Same thing with girls wrestling is and what I think in 3A too is think of the opportunities that are out there for just mass numbers that are in 3A of young women that are at home not doing anything. You know, maybe they don't want to be a cheerleader. Maybe they're not going to be on basketball. I mean, there can only be 5. So I just there's a big opportunity out there in the waiting for, I think, a lot of these bigger schools. It's just you got to maybe find that one person or have some resources. I don't know what it may be. But I expect those things to continue to evolve and people figure out how can we be like Waverly and have that many, you know, girls out for our program. I mean, they have two rooms. That can't happen.
I know they do.
Yeah, that can't happen no. all over the state, right? I mean, we're not. Right. I don't think anyone's asking for that. What I think is interesting about your perspective is doing things right, and I am worried about some of these other states that are like, all right, we're sanctioning it, and did they just do it because they got pressure, or do they actually have a plan in place? And I guess that's a lot of. I'd be curious to see how many sanctioned this past year, like in the past season, and you know what their plans are going forward here. So I guess we can learn from other states, and we need to ask for help. One thing I've learned too is with women's wrestling is you ask for it, they could be somebody that you don't like or they have never liked you. In women's wrestling, if you ask for help, they are likely going to help you do whatever it takes to build a program for women's wrestling.
You said opportunities. I mean, just from a college standpoint alone, scholarships. I mean, you can't tell me parents wouldn't be all in for that. So I think getting that word out, you're right. I think it has to be somebody in the school that's recruiting girls to give this a shot. Coaches, head coaches, assistant coaches right now, I don't know how they're doing it. You know, we have 1,100 kids in our school. I don't know how, we try to get to all those when we're trying to run a program. But I mean, you look at wrestling as a whole, from a senior level perspective, women's wrestling saved Olympic wrestling for us. And to not give all girls and women that opportunity to be a part of that and grow this, would be dumb on our part. I mean, what other sport do you see that could double their participation by allowing girls to wrestle, to compete? Wrestling. It's huge. It's huge.
And one thing where I see people are frustrated with the Iowa Girls Association is, you know, their mentality is, you know, to put those, give them the opportunities, right? And we're seeing it as they're not taking the ball and running with it. They're kind of leaning on the High School Athletic Association, and the High School Athletic Association has to lean on them, and we're just butting heads. And for you guys that are tuning in right now that aren't familiar with what's going on here in Iowa, is we're the only state with two organizations, and you know there's boards and there's lots of dollar figures that go into this and egos, and who wants to put their finger on that? And that at the bottom line, Jack, I think we could if we had 15, say we have 1,500 girls, 2,000 girls, what is that number to build that infrastructure, and what's it going to take for the Girls Association to say something and do it? I mean, that's I think what everybody wants to know is, what is the actual number? What do we have to do to prove to Gene Berger and company to sanction girls wrestling?
I feel like that line keeps moving. That every time that I've heard as a coach that, hey, we need to do this. We need to have this many girls participate and this many schools send letters to the girls union. We meet those guidelines and it just stalls. That being said, sometimes it's not a lot different in the boys association either. When as coaches, we feel like we have this voice to maybe change state duels or those different things. And that doesn't happen right away. So I do think it's a process. I hope from the athletic union, the girls athletic union standpoint, that they are really taking this to heart and are making those decisions to ensure that they have a good process moving forward. I don't know what the last girl sport that was sanctioned by them. So I don't know what that process is.
Yeah, well, I was in a meeting when they were discussing, this was back 2 years ago now, and the conversation at the table was, we don't have a rule set in place of, like, you need to have these check marks off in order to sanction the sport. You know, soccer didn't have to go through certain things. Bowling didn't have to do that. There is no table of contents that can lay these things out, which I thought was just absolutely insane. But nonetheless, you know, I think we're doing the most we can with IWCOA. Waverly has moved from Waverly to an arena now in Iowa City. I'm pumped for that to happen. So, you know, do what we can right now. And then eventually, if the numbers continue to grow and we've got districts, four districts a year, someone's going to have to do something, right? So that leads me into another, the next topic here, Coach. You talked about how the coaches are trying to voice their opinion, have a say, and direct maybe moving the sport forward, and that was the IWCOA or the state duels. And Louis, did you have a chance to listen to the podcast last week? Because the news really hasn't come out yet about what exactly is happening, right, other than what's on the podcast in regards to 1A and 2A. They are going to no longer have so the sectional champs. They're doing away with, you know, how they're using the IWCOA rankings to feed the state tournament, essentially. That was the biggest thing I took away from the state duels.
I did get a chance to listen to that, and I have some mixed feelings on all of that, because you know, state duels have only been around 25 or 30 years, and I'm sure that, but they fought tooth and nail to get that. So now we have it, and I know that things have changed, but that we need to roll with the punches for a little bit. I think any organization, continuous improvement is the thing that they need to do. Meaning that, we have it this way. What can we do to make it better? I think looking at, what they're doing with 1A and 2A is a step in the right direction. I do get a little, apprehensive about how they do 3A from the coaches voting on that, because it's so hard to, when you get a little bit later in the season, to truly take the time and go through those rankings and make sure that they're accurate. You're ranking 24 teams. That's a lot of teams to go down. I think that we want to be in that. And I know I've talked to some head coaches that say, you know what? We're not ever going to be in that position, so we don't worry about it. We were on the outside looking in, for the first 3 years when we were in Ankeny, not making it to a regional duel. But to me, that's where you want your program to head. I look at teams that win the state duels and the traditional state tournament. That's the Ironman of Iowa high school wrestling. If you can win those in a span of 4 days, you're doing something right. That's where we want to be. And if that's where the tournament is set for a few more years, that's still what I want to be. I want to be the team that wins that, on a Wednesday night and then comes back on a Saturday and wins it. It's about mindset from a coaching standpoint. And we used to hate going to the CIML because it was such a meat grinder. And I'm like, it can't be that way. You've got to have a better mindset. You've got to love that tournament. Same thing with state duels. If that's not going to change your mindset, right? You've got to look at that as that's what you want. You want to be in that, because sitting at home on a Wednesday night of that regional duel is not enjoyable. I'd much rather be wrestling. Even if we get beat by 50 points from Southeast Polk, I want to be there. That's where you're moving your program forward.
Well, the thing that you said is moving your program forward. And when I was talking with Louie last week, when it comes to the IWCOA rankings, everyone knows I'm on throw those out. Not saying that there definitely are coaches that take the time to look at records, but there's, I don't know the actual percentage, but higher percentage of them, and I don't blame them. That's the thing, is I don't blame them for not wanting to do it or have the time to do it, especially like 1A. Like, I mean, these guys are farmers. Some of them are teachers. When they go home from wrestling practice, they got families. Are they supposed to stand up till 10, 11 o'clock at night looking at rankings? No, they're gonna ask their buddy, hey, I don't have time. Who should I rank? And usually it's the programs that they're familiar with, like, oh, okay, Underwood's probably good. They're number one. Yep. You know, so I feel like that system is broken. And with 3A, Coach, NG with this, is moving your program forward. So, like, I've watched Johnson, been a part of Johnson kind of coming up, and those rankings do mean a big deal to whether your team gets to be in those or not. And whether you move on or not doesn't – I mean, yes, at the end of the day, probably the top eight teams that make it to state are probably the top eight teams. And there might be a couple that miss it, right? But that regional duel is so big for some of these schools that are trying to get people out for wrestling, get little kids to see – little Johnny, or, you know, Big Johnny, little Johnny seeing Big Johnny, I'd be like, holy cow, I want to be Sam Callum next year. You know, when I get old, I want to be Sam Callum. I want to be Caleb Ratchie. Like, they have a bigger effect than people are thinking. And when your team doesn't get there, it sucks. Just like you said.
I agree with all of that. There's always a better way. I mean, I think that's that continuous improvement. You plan, do, check, act. You have a plan, you check it. If it needs change, change it, right? I heard Chad Beeman talk 3 or 4 years ago that, you know, I think it was a push maybe 10 years ago that, hey, whatever system you're using for this, is it working? Let's change it and have the coaches do it. Oh, yeah, we're on board with that. Let's do that. And now we're at a point where maybe that needs changed again. The thing is that those dual meets hinge so much at the beginning of the year where you're maybe preseason ranked or just a couple dual meets in. And if you lose a dual meet at the wrong time, then you're out. You're going to be looking at wrestling the number one or number two seed if you're fortunate enough to get by that first round of the regional duel. But I will say this too, that, you know, I've had coaches come up to me, oh man, you guys really got screwed on that regional duel. It got Southeast Polk again. And, you know, my answer to that is, you know what? We got to win the dual meets we're supposed to win. And, you know, we're not doing that right now. So I don't throw it just on the rankings. I put myself in responsible for that, because we're not beating the Johnstons. We're not beating the Centennials. Those dual meets are killing us. And if you're not winning that, then your ranking isn't going to be there. We saw it with Johnston and Centennial this year that, I think Johnston beat them in a dual meet towards the end of the year, and it wasn't reflective in the, dual meet rankings, and it kind of hurt. That's the kind of stuff that I know that could be changed if the system was different. So yeah, that's my perspective on that.
So the state duels gets brought up all the time. I mean, you're sitting around like, God dang, the state duels they need to change. But I do like your perspective. Like, okay, this is what we have. This is all we can do. You know, we can't really sit around and mope about it. But one thing that was proposed, I did find out that it was proposed, the Iowa High School Athletic Association did propose that sectionals would go away and state duels would take on that weekend. Not sure, you know, as far as qualifying process goes, when those fall, where conference championships, you know, if it would take place on that weekend or what exactly. But, you know, if you could switch from the way the system is now to having state duels the week prior to the district tournament, what are your thoughts on that for your team?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a situation where that's a change that people would be for, because they don't like them where they're at now. I went to college with some guys from Riceville, and they were always in state duels. They said, we hated state duels after the traditional state tournament. We were done, and we had to keep our weight down the entire time. So sometimes don't ask for what you want. You might just get it. So they changed it the day before the traditional state tournament. I know that they proposed that, which I think is great. And I'd be good with that. You know, it's all about how you want to approach it. Oh gosh, we can't have state duels the week before districts. You know, what if a kid gets hurt? Well, you know, it's no different than having it the day before the traditional starts. So I know that they can find a happy medium there. I talked to Tecklenburg and about this, and he said North Carolina does it awesome.
Yeah.
He goes, they do it great, and it is hugely attended. You know, the state tournament being seeded now out to 16, I think that shows the forward thinking of the association that they haven't had for a while. And if you're willing to make that change and it's just not status quo anymore, then anything's on the table. How they put districts together, how they do state duels, are they going to get rid of sectionals? I like that. We've got to be more progressive, that is for sure. And I think that Louis Curtis has taken us down that road.
North Carolina is crazy. I have talked to Tech about that. And I like that. It makes every single time I talk to Tech about this, I'm like, man, that makes a lot of sense. But it's a big change, right? And I do understand the aspect of having it on Wednesday, because there's people on that side too that they just like coming and making it get it done. You know, they like to know that, you know, they go to school on Monday, maybe a little bit on Tuesday, but I mean, and then the rest of the week they're in Des Moines. It's vacation for wrestling fans, right? So I see the positives in that too, and there's going to be positives to and negatives to switching it to sectionals, right? You lose sectionals, you take a lot of revenue from a lot of schools, right? That's one thing. If we get rid of regionals, how much revenue is getting taken out? So there's so many ways that this gets changed, and positives and negatives, I guess. So too, I wanted to go into this, unless you had anything else on that topic, but
nope.
So ADs were forwarded something from the High School Athletic Association on Friday, and I'm not sure when the coaches received this or not, but in regards to having Zoom meetings and having that contact with your athlete, right now is an important time to keep that morale. Some people don't have parents that are motivators or whatnot, and they need that coach, right? So this is an important time for you to be in their lives. What did come down from your AD, and how did you interpret it?
Well, it was what is usually done with contact in the spring, and that you are limited to, or not limited. You can't have any contact with your athletes from a coaching wrestling perspective. During that time frame from when your season's over to when school's out in the fall or in the spring, so a little different time right now, right? With the way COVID-19 has done all this stuff, and it just reiterated that with the point of you can't have Zoom lifts, you can't be working out with your kids over Zoom. I know that. I have a Zoom meeting with my kids, but it is not not wrestling related. It is just, hey, how are you guys doing mentally, physically? Are you staying active? Are you staying healthy? Those things. And that's not a conversation that I wouldn't have at school with a kid if we were in session. So it's not a lot different than what we've seen, other than where we're at with this virus. So pretty typical for the most part, except for that part.
Yeah, so nothing is changing a whole lot. Just now coaches know what Zoom is.
Well, if you teach, you know what Zoom is. If you coach, you're gonna learn it real quick if you want to ever see your athletes again, it seems like. So
what are some of the things that you're doing or maybe telling your athletes, or I guess maybe if you can't have the contact, what are some things that your wrestlers are working on right now to kind of prepare for whenever they get to go back on the mat?
Right. Well, I don't get much in return at all. They're either on it or they're not. They get the messages. Hey, I hope you guys are doing all right. And there are kids that are working out and there are kids that are probably sitting on the couch playing video games. And it's tough to get them engaged in the freestyle season, even when you're in school. And now that we don't even have that opportunity right now, it's even become more difficult. I'm finding that as a teacher, getting kids engaged at all is like pulling teeth. And, it is a very unique situation that I'm sure every coach in every sport is dealing with right now. From my perspective as a wrestling coach, our kids that are those fringe kids, I call them, that maybe aren't full-time wrestlers that we get in the room in the spring, are really missing out on an opportunity to get better right now because of the way things are. And it's really unfortunate, really unfortunate.
The mental side of things is what I'm really worried about. I mean, the physical side of things, yeah, but at the end of the day, they're kids, right?
Right.
Us dads, we're just getting fat. But the kids got good metabolism. But mental side of things of, you know, having a coach like you, any coach, say, hey, you know, you're going to go to school, have lunch after school, this is what you're going to do. And you don't have that anymore. And parents aren't used to doing that. And let's be real, like, kids don't listen to parents really a whole lot of times anyways, right? They do want to do the opposite.
Yep.
You got six girls, so I've got one. Yeah. I've got one, and she is a damn firecracker. So I can only imagine having six of them. So you feel free to say no comment. Also what got brought up on the discussion, and I want to get your perspective on this, is freestyle wrestling. And what have you seen from some of those kids that have gone to freestyle and come back? You know, is there a huge difference in that wrestler? Maybe they were just on the fringe and, hey, I'm going to go out for freestyle. Do you think it just changed? I think some, I'll have my comments, but what do you see mentally from the wrestlers that never did freestyle before get involved in freestyle wrestling?
I think like most things, just taking that first step to do it is the hardest for kids. They see maybe some highlights of some kid getting bombed, you know, for 5 points, and they're like, there's no way I can do that. But you get a kid who will buy into a little bit of that, and get a taste of it. And it really, really changes their perspective. I look at a kid like Kale Cox, who wanted to be a football player, and, you know, the kid is just not very big, and, he's a great athlete and he works hard. But he needed freestyle, and he got in on that and loves it. Qualified for Fargo last year. It completely changed who that kid was. Back when Derek Huber, he was a year older than Austin Anderson. He had some good teams, and, Derek wasn't even going to wrestle as a ninth grader. Coach Ewing got him out, and that transition year from his, I think his 10th grade to his 11th grade year, he wrestled probably 80 freestyle matches, state qualifier, changed his mindset. Those kids are missing that. I saw a tweet from Nomad. This was probably 5 or 6 weeks ago. And he said that, I really feel bad for those kids that are in 7th and 8th grade that are really starting to make a jump, that are going to miss out on this time and maybe even not go back to wrestling. That's a hard pill to swallow right now. Yeah. And so much truth in that. The thing is that we don't have any control over this right now. All we can do is control what we can control, and we'll have to deal with it when we come out of this. You try to stay in contact with your athletes the best you can. And that's all we can do right now. But that freestyle season is huge, and kids are missing it. And I know I have kids that are on the bubble that I wish could have this, because I know they were in after the season. They're like, yep, when we start up in March, man, he goes, we'll be going. And they're not getting that chance right now. And it's just frustrating.
Yeah, and one thing also, too, in regards to summer wrestling, with some schools, where we were talking about how Iowa really has fallen off as far as being a national powerhouse in freestyle, and that's kind of trickled down to folk style a little bit too, is coaches, and maybe it's the kids, of pushing their kids to wrestle in the summer. Especially 1A and 2A, we got a lot of wrestlers are star baseball players, right? But in 3A, I do feel like there's a lot more kids specializing in one sport. But do you, as a coach that also is dealing with Ankeny Centennial, where is there nerves of losing kids to a different program if you can't have your hands on them? Maybe your job doesn't allow you. Maybe this is you or not. Doesn't allow you because in the summer you take a different job. You can't go on the weekends. You can't go to the tournaments. You can't go to practice during the week. Is there fear of losing your kids if you let them free and go and work out with other clubs?
I guess yes and no to that. I don't know. I'm kind of on the fence about that. Kids will go where competition is if their parents' financial means will allow them, meaning that they can sell a house and buy a house or they're open to the transfer. We're really fortunate in Ankeny. We have three mat wrestling rooms, and our club is 250 kids, and we have to split that. Our coaches, are incredible. Guys like Brad Brewell and Kirk Rachi and Bobby Anderson and David Kildow. I know I'm going to miss some. Kurt Backus is on that staff, and Kurt Benetham. And so we are very, very fortunate in Ankeny to have what we have. And I don't worry too much about kids going elsewhere, but I also try to be as active as I can be during the spring, and especially during the summer, with camps and freestyle. And my hands are a little tied. Like I said, I have a lot of kids and that family time is important to me. And so I try to balance that the best I can. That's what wrestling does for me, is the balance. So you have six girls and, you got to have some of that testosterone time. So that's what wrestling is for me, it does get to be, I don't want to say a worry, but we've seen a lot of that, with kids going to different schools and doing things, and transferring. I wish they wouldn't. Honestly, I wish they would stick around, I'm sure, some school would love to have had a Caleb Rachi come there. Some of that with two is just parents saying, hey, you know what? This is what we are. We're Hawks. We're in the club program. We're going to stay where we're at.
Yeah. You want the Hawks telling people to come to Ankeny. In the world where we kind of change things, where we go, the transfer situation is rampant in all sports, not just wrestling, right? But I just kind of was using that because that's what I'm familiar with.
Yeah.
And it brings me to my next topic here, Coach, was last couple years, initially when I thought Centennial was coming in, that it was going to be, button heads and fighting over kids and getting kids to move just, across the block or a mile down to be – that's what I was worried about and thought. How did that all go down? Were those things – you don't have to mention anybody, but were those things happening in your favor or not your favor when that initial split happened?
I don't think so. It's funny. Some of the kids that would have went to either side ended up going to different schools altogether. I'm trying to think – the kid that wrestled for Dowling, then he went to Iowa City West, starts with an R. I'm just losing it. He was originally from Ankeny, him and his brother both. Then he wrestled at UNI. Rowater.
Yep.
He was an Ankeny kid.
Tanner. Yeah.
So was, the kid that won a state title or was a runner up for, Dowling.
Hagen?
Big tall kid. No, wrestling for Iowa State right now. I wasn't prepared to talk about all that stuff. I can't remember his name.
Yeah. No, you're good.
Big tall kid. He's really grown. I think he's a heavyweight up there now. I think his name,
that's going to drive me nuts too. I know who you're talking about.
Those were Ankeny kids. So it wasn't so much they were going north or south. They were going to different schools because they didn't want to be a part of that split anymore. We're seeing a little bit of that now in some of the other sports.
Caden Sauer. Caden Sauer.
Yeah, Caden Sauer. Thank you. I've been approached about, from parents about kids coming south, and I tell them one thing: buy a house. I'm not going to go through this. You did this. You recruited this kid. You did that. I'm not going to play that game. We're going to win with Ankeny Hawks, and that's how we're going to do it. But it hasn't been like that as much as it could have been, or people maybe thought it would be.
Yeah.
It is fine where we're at.
Not
with
like,
things.
And not like Jay's a competitive guy, right?
Right.
Good dude. Anyway, one thing that I'll be watching is Waukee. So they're splitting as well. And there's definitely a program that has been kind of fringe rising, right? They had a good year. This year they were kind of all over. And you know, who goes where, who comes in a new program, and you know, do people move, like all that kind of drama. So it's good to hear that there wasn't anything too crazy, and the kids that were on the fringe ended up going anywhere, and their mind's going to be made up anyways. If they're willing to flip, like you say, like we right. want them to be Hawks. If they're willing to flip, then do you really want them on your program anyways? But
right. I couldn't agree with you more on that point. I know that there were a couple athletes that went up from the south side to the north side this past school year, and that was kind of the mentality I think they had, that all right, if you don't feel like you're getting what you need on the south side, go ahead and go north. We'll let the chips fall where they may. So it happens.
So I know when we talked before the weekend here, we said we could probably talk for 3-4 hours.
yeah.
So we've kind of tried to like kind of get through all of them here, but is there any topic that you wanted to jump on here while we've got time? I got one last thing I want to end on here, just about you coaching.
Well, I just want to in this part of it with the opportunity that my coaching staff is incredible. Austin Anderson, you know, he volunteered. I think maybe my second year was on paid staff, his third year. He wanted to come back and give back to the program, but I don't think he realized where we were at until he was actually in it. And for him to help me, help us grow this program to where it's at, you know, guys like Dave Ewing and Brian Sharp and Dave Sharp and, have been so instrumental in, the success we've had in this isn't my program. It's our program. They put as much time and effort in as I do. And I'm so grateful for all of that. And you know, this success wouldn't be where it's at unless we had a hell of a club. The guys that run that club are incredible. The kids that come out of that club, are ready to go. People ask me, well, how are you guys doing? I said, good. I said, and we're going to be that way for 10 more years. And I just say 10 because I know that I have a nephew that's in fifth grade, and he's going to be coming up through the program. He's a Southside kid, and I just know who those kids are and how good they are and where they're at. And, you know, and I realize that some kids don't always pan out and some kids quit, and I get that. But what that club is doing and producing the athletes they have for both sides of town, unbelievable. We're very fortunate. It's only going to get better.
Yeah, that's positive that they can be combined, right? In sheer numbers.
Yeah.
You know, that's big, that decided not to peel off and do their own thing. That when in a sport with a ton of egos, that's special to have and to kids go to where they get to go. And I want to one last thing here I want to get to is actually I got two things. so hopefully you got time.
I got time.
A kid I want to bring up and I haven't talked to you about this. I've talked to Austin a little bit about it, but Trevor Anderson.
Yep.
When I first saw him wrestle, I'm a former wrestler too, media obviously, but like I can tell in someone's eyes, like they're just so damn competitive. And, you know, Trevor not getting what he wanted, at the state tournament. What are some, you know, what was that like for you as a coach, and what are some things that maybe, you did to help him kind of get through some of those tough times?
You know, you brought this up a little bit earlier, and that was, the pressure of coaching, right? What I've learned going from not being very good to being pretty competitive is that the better you get, the harder it is. and a lot of that, I would say all of that is probably, the pressure I put on myself to have our teams perform. And it's just not me, but I'm going to take that responsibility, if we don't do well. And I'm going to heap praise on people when we do well. Because ultimately I am the leader of that, and I'm going to take that responsibility. Trevor, that's a really great question. You know, as a coach, I'm going to second guess stuff. I second guess putting him down in the second period, in that match with Ryder Downey. And this isn't anything against Ryder, because that kid's improved so much. It's crazy. I mean, he's made the effort. He's made the work to get to where he's at, and great match, great, wrestling by them from a game plan. But as I second guess myself, and I've talked to a lot of, my coaching staff and former wrestlers and people. And I said, you know, maybe I shouldn't have put him down. They're like, no. You can't put him down. So I look at that perspective and think, all right. I should have went deferred or went neutral. So be it. The side of it for me was, we were sitting at a training room Saturday morning after, before we headed to weigh-ins. And, I don't think I slept that night at all, knowing that Trevor got beat like that. Not that nobody else mattered, because it did. Awesome for Sam Callen getting in the finals. Caleb, two-time finalist, two-time state champ. But, we were sitting at a training room all around, and Trevor's kind of like, oh man, we played right into his game plan to go, he wanted us to go down and ride me. And I looked at, I think I took the air out of the room when I said, Trevor, if I can't put my defending state champ down in the second period to go up, 3-0 with another takedown in that second period and go up 5-0 and win that match, I said, who in the heck am I going to put down in the second period to win that match? And, you know, because I think Trevor, he was still struggling with it, rightfully so. But I would say after that day, he was over that. And I've talked to him since quite a bit about it. And he couldn't agree more that he's got to be able to get out in that scenario. And I know I had talked to Caleb, it was a week or two after the state tournament. And he goes, the best match that I saw Trevor wrestle all year was, against a kid from Bondurant in the debuting duels. And we needed a major out of Trevor to win that dual meet. And it was against a good kid. I think that kid ended up fourth. And Trevor went out there against a good kid. And took him down, let him up, took him down, let him up, push. And that's how he needed to be against Ryder Downey in the semis. He needed to be able to get out and push that pace, and he just didn't. Is that nerves? I would hope so. I mean, that's a lot of pressure. You're going for your second title. You know, you need to get past this kid to give yourself that chance. And, you know, you wrestled this kid 9 times and beat him 9 times. That's hard to beat somebody 3 times, let alone 10 times. So there were just a lot of things that played into that. But that's one that kept me up and that I think about a lot. I mean, still, that'll always stay with me. To be able to go back in that match and, what could I have done as a coach differently? But, it's over with, and now we move on.
Yeah, as an individual, you're always thinking about your individual matches, but then as a coach, you're thinking about now you got two. You got how many matches to think about that don't go your way? So I want to leave with this, coach, and I'm not sure if you saw the graphic or not, but I just reached out to Caleb Ratchie late last night. I just said, you know, what's one thing you could say about coach? Maybe to stir up a conversation. And he said, and I wasn't really expecting this. I thought he was gonna say, yeah, you know, he's a hard nosed coach and he's taught me so much, blah blah blah. But he said like one thing that caught him off guard, he noticed that you were relaxed and you were funny when it came to the state tournament. Do you think that, or is that just how you're?
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, that the better you get, the more pressure you put on yourself, and I'm competitive. I don't ever want to lose. And so that comes out and it seems as though we have had some really, really good teams. The last 3 years, we get into the district tournament and we're against, Polk. And in the year that we were over at, Waukee, Glenwood had a phenomenal team. We just happened to get put with these teams that were just so, so good. And I, again, this comes to mindset. I told the kids, hey, this is never, ever going to change. We can't hope for an easier district. We have to get better, which is when we started implementing the lifting and having another team come in and practice with us. So leading up to that district tournament, I mean, there were years that I didn't know if we would have a qualifier. And then even when we got better, knowing that kids like, Sam Callum and Derek Anderson and, Kale Cox, had a kid named Luke Sable. There were 30 match winners going into the district tournament and nobody got out. Those kids didn't get out. I take a lot of responsibility for that. What do we need to do? What do we have to do to get these kids through? Because we got to get better. We just can't hope for an easier district. But once I would get past that district tournament, I was able to let my guard down a little bit. You just get into the zone as a coach. And my oldest daughter, she's 28 and lives out in Boston, and she goes, I go radio silent during wrestling season because I get so hyper focused to what I'm doing. And I really do. It's so important for me, knowing how much work these kids are putting in, to have them get to that state tournament and have some success. Not that that is the end all be all in wrestling, but any kid that has ever wrestled knows that that's the place to be and that's where they want to be. And as a coach, that's where I want them and that's where I think they deserve to be. So until we get past that district tournament, especially getting toward the end of that season, I do get pretty, pretty serious and just, I don't even know if serious is the right word, just tense. I have a hard time letting that go. But once we hit that district tournament and we get some kids through, 2 years ago when we got Derek Anderson and Sam Callum through and Caleb and that was just great because I know how much time Sam and Derek Anderson had put in, and not that the other kids didn't, but those kids needed that. They both lost matches at the regional duel the Wednesday before. And they needed to beat those kids to qualify, and they did it. So that, to me, that was the real turning point in our program, is that we got those kids through, and that was growth. That was real growth for our program.
Well, Coach, I appreciate you taking the time coming on. I'm sorry I rushed you there towards the end of your meeting.
No, not at all.
So.
I'm glad it worked out. I really enjoyed this time. This is, you know, I don't like the spotlight at all. I don't. I'll let Austin take that any day of the week with that hair he has. I know that you guys do a great job. The media coverage that we have in Iowa with the different outlets is huge. And I know that, again, this is an opportunity for me to grow our program and let people don't know who I am, I don't think, for the most part, which I don't care. I really don't.
You guys should,
I just want to coach wrestling and get my kids through.
I think people are going to have a new appreciation for you because you got six girls, okay? And that's not easy. So I appreciate you jumping on.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. Thanks for the time today, Tony.
All right, that's been another episode of Potentially Dangerous. We're coming back next week here live at 12. We're going to start right on the dot. Hopefully we can we'll get a coach that isn't going to be late. I'm just screwing with you, coach. But, yes, the archives will be we'll have this on Rokfin. We're going to have it here on social media here for a little bit. But hopefully you can subscribe to our Rokfin channel. That is something that we launched, you know, right around state wrestling tournament, and that is going to be so huge for us going into this season. Able to pay the men and women that help IAwrestle and provide the coverage for you, where we've got some big things planned for the upcoming season, and we're excited to bring it to you. So for everybody IAwrestle, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks, Tony.